بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم الحمد لله رب العالمين صلى الله وسلم وبارك على خاتم النبيين على آله وصحبه أجمعين. Continuing what we have started long time ago, talk about the case of the Hadith of Jibreel عليه السلام. The famous Hadith which is mentioned as Hadith Jibreel. That Hadith that Umar ibn Khattab رضي الله عنه said, as narrated by Muslim and the others, that while we were sitting with Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, a stranger came in. Stranger with a black hair, clean clothes, not a traveler and not from Medina people. He came to the place or the sitting of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, and he sat to Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, and he asked him about Islam and Iman and Ihsan and the signs of the hour or the last day of this earth. And we said that we started to talk about La ilaha illallah Muhammad Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam as the first pillar of Islam. And we said that this La ilaha illallah will be beneficial for the person who says it only if he has three conditions. Only if he has three conditions. That he knows the true meaning of La ilaha illallah, that he practice that meaning on his life, and then the third condition is to be free of the contradictions of La ilaha illallah, which is the contradictions of Islam also. We finished talking about the first two conditions, and the third condition, which is the being free of the contradictions of Islam. We finished eight of them already, that was up to last week. Tonight, inshallah, we will talk about the ninth contradiction of Islam, or La ilaha illallah, which is whomsoever thinks that he can live without the Sharia of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Whoever thinks that he know he is capable of living without practicing the Sharia of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, or he can have a way to have another Sharia, whether from others or from Allah, but not through Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. This case is dangerous and could lead a person to be out of Islam because of some points we have to talk about tonight. First of all, let us see. Is the message of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam Islam? Is it for Arabs only? Is it for some people? Yani, if you remember, all the messages before Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, their message were for their nation. So Musa alayhi salam, his message was only for the Jews. Also Isa alayhi salam, and Sulaiman, and Dawood, all of these, their message is only for Bani Israel. The message of Ibrahim alayhi salam for his people. The message of Nuh was only for his people. But the message of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, for all mankind, not only, but even the jinn. The message of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam is for human beings and for the jinn also. So in this case, the message of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam is a general message. Every person who met Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam from that time up to date, up to the end of this earth, is part of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam nation. And he must accept Islam, and he cannot use any other religion because it's all rejected. As he sallallahu alayhi wa sallam told us in his hadith, لا يسمع بي يهودي ولا نصراني ثم لا يؤمن بي إلا دخل النار. Even if those people who say that they are truly following Musa, if the true Torah is available still, even those people who say that they still follow Isa alayhi salam, if the Injil or the Bible is still, although we know they are both of them are not there. So once Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam was walking, he met Umar ibn Khattab carrying one paper or few papers of At-Tawrah, Old Testament. So Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam got so angry, and he told Umar, which means, are you having any doubt of what I have, Ya Umar? If Musa was alive, he had no other choice but to follow me. If Musa was alive, he had no other choice but to follow me. Subhanallah. Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam was the last messenger, and every messenger must follow him if they are alive. وإذا أخذ الله ميثاق النبيين لما آتيتكم من كتاب وحكمة ثم جاءكم رسول مصدق لما معكم لتؤمنن به ولتنصرنه قال أقررتم قال أقررتم أخذتم على ذلكم إصري قالوا أقررنا. So every messenger Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala whispered to him that if Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam comes to you, you should follow him. And they all admitted that. Now let's come to the point. If the message of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam is for every human being and also for jinn, as these hadith have mentioned, also Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala told us, وَمَا أَرْسَلْنَاكَ إِلَّا كَافَّةً لِلنَّاسِ بَشِيرًا وَنَذِيرًا. So he's Bashir al-Nadir for everybody. So if this is the fact, if this is the fact that Muhammad's message is for all alive people and jinn from his time up to the end of this earth, then we will come to the point we are talking about, which is the contradiction in here. There are some people think that they have the choice to use some other sharia than the sharia of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Like what? Like who? Like the secularists. Secularists think that deen or Islam is only for the personal cases. Yani marriage, divorce, other things. But for the politics side of life, for the economic side of life, Islam is not there. But what are they going to, which sharia they are going to use? They are going to use the sharia of the others, the law, American law or British law or Swiss law and so on. Subhanallah al-Azim. So these people think that they are not supposed to follow Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam in this case. And sharia of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam is not complete, which is very dangerous, as we will talk about when we talk about the bid'ah or novelty. The other group, and there are a lot of groups of course, but we are trying to talk about the major ones. The extremist Sufis. I'm not saying Sufis, no, I'm saying extremist Sufis, because some Sufis are close to Sunnah. But extremist Sufis, they think that they don't need to read Al-Bukhari or Muslim or even read the Quran. So what are they going to do? They say, Allah, my heart told me about Allah directly. So they think they can talk to Allah directly, and Allah talking to them directly. They don't need to go through Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam or through that and that. So they say to Ahl Sunnah wal Jama'ah, you are taking your deen from dead people. They mean that Bukhari said, our Shaykh said such name and such name, until the Sahabi bin Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. They say, all these people have died already. So we don't take our deen from these dead people, we take it directly from Allah, the one who is alive. Subhanallah. How bad is this? How strange is this? Those people think that they are better than Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, because Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam did not take it direct from Allah. Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam did not receive his message, Islam, from Allah. He said it through Jibreel alayhi wa sallam. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala did not talk to any human beings except some people are mentioned, as you know, like Musa alayhi wa sallam, when Allah told us, وَكَلَّمَ اللَّهُ مُوسَى تَكْلِيمًا. So those people who think that they do not need the sharia of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, they can go directly to take their knowledge from Allah directly, they think that they are better than Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. A'udhu billah. And if a person thinks like this, he is a completely kafir, he is out of Islam. What are they using? What evidence they are using in this case? They are using this one evidence they misunderstood. The evidence of Al-Khadr. You know Al-Khadr alayhi salam? That man who met Musa alayhi salam. When Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala sent Musa to go and learn some knowledge from Al-Khadr. So Musa and his servant went, as Allah told us in Surah Al-Kahf. If you read Surah Al-Kahf, the last few pages, Allah has told us about Al-Khadr and Musa alayhi salam when he went to meet him. So Musa, when he met that man, he started to talk to him. So he told him, just follow me, don't ask me any questions. So he, the first of all, a ship. So Al-Khadr made a hole in that ship. So Musa was so angry, why are you breaking this and destroying this ship? So he told him, didn't I tell you not to ask me any question? He said, okay, I'm sorry, I'm going too far. So he followed him, okay? Then they met a child. Al-Khadr killed him. So Musa was so angry, why are you killing a child who has not done anything wrong? Again he told him, didn't I told you not to ask me anything? So Musa said, okay, fine. They went to a town. They wanted them to give them some food. They refused. The people of the town refused to give them any food. So Al-Khadr went to a place and he built a falling wall. So Musa said, yeah, you, you made this war for them, why they did not give us any food? Why didn't you ask for money for it, at least so we can eat? So he told him, halas, that's it. You have asked me three times now, I gave you three chances, you're still asking me, so he told him the story. However, Al-Khadr in this case, those people say that Al-Khadr could and had the chance and had the right not to follow Musa's Sharia or Sharia of Musa. So we also have the chance not to follow the Sharia of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Subhanallah, what kind of evidence is this? First of all, was Al-Khadr Wali or a prophet or Nabi? Some people say, some scholars of Islam say that Al-Khadr was only a Wali. Some other scholars say that Al-Khadr was a Nabi or a prophet. Even though, still Al-Khadr is not part of the nation of Musa alayhi salam. And Musa was sent only for Bani Israel. Al-Khadr was not from Bani Israel. So he is not required to follow the Sharia of Musa. Clear, brothers? Al-Khadr was not required to follow the Sharia of Musa alayhi salam because he was not one of the Bani Israel. And Musa was only sent by Allah Ta'ala only to Bani Israel. But in our case, it differs. Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam was sent to all the nations who are alive, from his time up to the end of this earth. So Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam is sent also to the Arabs, not only the Arabs, but also all the people around us in this world. In Europe, in America, in all of this, he is sent to them. So his Sharia is required and must and mandatory for all of this. Then they come these extremist Sufis, they say, no. We will take our Sharia directly from Allah. Subhanallah al-Azim. Subhanallah, yani they know better than Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Astaghfirullah. In this case, this will lead us to talk about the case of Bid'ah. The paper you have is talking about the case of Bid'ah or novelty. What do we mean by novelty or Bid'ah? Give me one paper. You see in the mind map, which is making it easy for you to follow, or the paper in here also, it's showing you more knowledge, at least to follow when we talk about, you find that we defined bid'ah or novelty as creating something new without any previous example. So creating something new is bid'ah, novelty. But actually bid'ah, this is linguistic definition. So it includes the life thing, yani to create a mobile or a car, or called bid'ah also. Yes, fine, this is under the linguistic definition. That's why we said after that bid'ah is two classes actually. Bid'ah is two classes. First class, inhabit, habitual life. Yani, if someone creates a car, yani in the time of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, there were no cars, no airplanes, no mobiles, okay? So these are called all bid'ah. It's new things that made without a previous example, but in life. And that's no problem. That's allowed in Islam. In fact, sometimes it's a must for Muslims to have bid'ah in these cases, to create new things, new cars, new computers, and so on. This is required. As long as it does not contradict with the Sharia of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, Quran and Sunnah. But in the other case, which is the second class, bid'ah or novelty in religion. And that's what we mean. That's the case we are talking about, which is really mentioned in the Quran and Sunnah, that is rejected. Listen to Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he's telling us, كل محدثة بدعة وكل بدعة ضلالة. كل here in Arabic means every. Oh, every. So every new thing in deen is ضلالة. كل ضلالة في النار. Subhanallah. Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, كل. And we have to put this in point because we'll come to it later on to see how these people say bid'ah hasana, good bid'ah or white bid'ah. Okay, we'll talk about later on. However, clearly Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam told us that whoever innovates anything in our deen or our matter which is Islam is rejected. Why bid'ah is so dangerous? Why we talk a lot about bid'ah or novelty? Why? Because actually those people who are falling into it or doing this bid'ah, they are falling into a major kufr. A person will lose his deen because when he says that he is making a new thing in deen, he is talking about one of two cases. Whether he is thinking that he knew something Muhammad Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam did not know. This is kufr. Or he is saying that that Muhammad Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam did not complete the deed. So he is completing the deed, this person, na'udhu billah. Both of them are kufr. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala told us clearly in his holy book, Al-yawma akmaltu lakum deenakum wa atmamtu alaykum ni'mati wa radhitu lakum al-islam deena. So deen is complete. Anybody have any suspicions in that? Any doubt? No doubt. Deen al-Islam is complete by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. So if someone says, no, I will complete the deen because it's not complete, he is a kafir. Or he says that Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam has hidden something, he is a kafir. Or he says that Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam forgot this or did not know this, he is a kafir, na'udhu billah. So those people who are adding to the deen, any of these cases, anything in deen, is there adding extra salah, adding extra dhikr, or they're changing the manner of the dhikr, as we'll talk about later inshallah, then they are falling into this case of saying that Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam did not complete the deen. Or they knew something that Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam did not do, or did not know. Actually bid'ah, or the forbidden bid'ah in deen, is counted or divided into two types as you see in your paper. Doctrinal spoken novelty, DSM, that happened by some of the groups in Islam, like Al-Khawarij, Al-Murji'ah, Al-Mu'tazil, and so on. The good example of this, or the bad example actually, is that those people who say that Quran was not descended to Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, Allah did not speak the Quran, He created Quran like He created anything else. This is not said by Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, not by Abu Bakr or Umar or Uthman or Ali. From where they get this? They only just did this because they want to, they thought they are defending Islam or trying to glorify Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, because they say if we say Allah spoke the Quran, then we will say Allah have a tongue, have teeth, have lips, astaghfirullah alazim. But they made the wrong action, the wrong thinking actually. Why? Because when we say that Allah spoke Quran, that's what He told us in His holy book. وَكَلَّمَ اللَّهُ مُوسَى تَكْلِيمًا. So He talked to Musa alayhi salam, and He also talked to Jibreel alayhi salam. He descended the Quran to Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. If you read the Holy Quran, you find so many ayahs telling us that Allah spoke Quran. Why are they changing this? Because they don't want to say that Allah is having this and this and that. But why don't they correct the case and say, fine, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala can't speak without need of this? No need, because Allah has His own way, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, His own capability, His great capability subhanahu wa ta'ala to do whatever He wants to do without having our needs of these materials like tongues and lips and teeth and so on. So this is one part of the bid'ah or novelty. The other one is worshipping novelty, which is the key. It's so spread among Muslims, unfortunately. You will see a lot of Muslims, they are making extra worshipping that's not done by Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam has told us clearly that he has completed the deed. So if someone comes and say, I want to make extra things to our deen, Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam told us that salah are five salah, fard, maktubah is five times a day. Al-Fajr, al-Zuhr, al-Asr, al-Maghrib, al-Isha. Someone say, okay, why five? Let's make it six. The more the better. No, ya Habibi, not the more the better. Because deen is complete. We cannot change or add. He says, okay, between al-Isha and al-Fajr, there's a long time, I will add extra salah. I'll make it midnight salah, like al-Fajr al-Dhuhr al-Asr. No, you cannot do it like this. Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam gave us five salah upon the words of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, khalas. We take it and we go on with it. If we want to make nafil extra, okay, fine. Nafil is open. A person can pray three rak'ah, one rak'ah, witr, three rak'ahs, five rak'ahs, seven rak'ahs, nine rak'ahs, 11 rak'ahs, 23 rak'ahs, no problem. Because all done by Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, so it's sunnah, not bid'ah. Not in a faulty, this is sunnah of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, if someone do it later. Because Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam also did this, did it 11 rak'ahs at night, he did it sometimes 23 rak'ahs, he did it sometimes 3 rak'ahs, depends on the condition of the person. Also al-duha, he can pray 2 rak'ahs up to 12 rak'ahs. After al-duha, he can pray as much as he can, and so on. But in this case, Muslims actually, unfortunately, because of ignorance of a lot of Muslims, because they love Islam, we think inshallah they love Islam, they wanted to make more worshipping. So what they do? They add, or they change the manner, or they change the time. Remember the Surah Al-Fatiha. Allah told us subhanahu wa ta'ala that people are three types. صراط الذين أنعمت عليهم. This is one type. Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam and his brothers of Nabiyeen and his Sahaba. غير المغضوب عليهم. Those are the Jew, the cursed people, and those Muslims who are knowing Islam and they are not practicing it, rejecting it, refusing it. ولا الضالين. The third type, those who are worshipping Allah with ignorance. Like Christians. Christians are ignorant people and they added to their deen things that are not there. Like Rahbaniyat al-Ibtada'uha. They made this deer outside of the cities and they stay there without marriage or any this and that. From where they got this? Did Allah order them? ما كتبناها عليهم. So the case is here that a Muslim should be following Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. He only does the ibadah. He only did the ibadah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam upon the order of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. When he sent him subhanahu wa ta'ala, in the beginning he told him in Surah Al-Muzzammil, Ya ayyuhal Muzzammil, qum al-layla illa qaleela, nisfahu wa anqus minhu qaleela, up to the end of the ayah. He told him to stood up the most of the night. So he did sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. He did not create from his own a way of worshipping, whether it's salah or zakah or sawm or hajj. He only did sallallahu alayhi wa sallam what Allah told him to do. We are also supposed to do the same thing. So when we love Islam, of course, every Muslim loves Islam. He loves Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Every Muslim loves Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Part of our love to Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam is to follow him. Not to create extra things. He clearly told us not, he did not allow us. He told us not to do this also. He told us not to change or add or put in Islam which is not there. من عمل عملا ليس عليه أمرنا هذا فهو رد. Rejected. Whoever makes extra in Islam, which is not done by Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam or by Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, it is rejected. Even if he makes so many good deeds, it is rejected. Remember we said two conditions to accept any deed. Only for Allah, only the way of Rasulullah. Only for Allah, that's ikhlas. That's part of shahadat an la ilaha illallah. Only by the way of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, that is follow-up. Following Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. That's part of shahadat anna Muhammad Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. So any worshipping will not be accepted unless with these two conditions. Now those people who are innovating or making bid'ah, novelty, are they following Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam? No. They are making from their own minds new or extra, or they change the way of worshipping. Note that the worshipping novelty could be in different ways. We made it four classes to make it easier to understand. Whether they make it in basis of the worship, yani they make from scratch. They make extra salah which is not mentioned at all, like midnight salah, as an example. That's from scratch. Or they make additions to a certain decreed worship. Like making al-fajr instead of two rak'ah, he said, no, he makes four rak'ah. So he's adding. This is also novelty, bid'ah, not allowed. Or he changed the manner of the worship, which is already decreed. Worship is decreed. So he changed the manner of it, like dhikr after salah. Muhammad Hassan told us how to do make dhikr after salah. Astaghfirullah, astaghfirullah, astaghfirullah. Allahumma anta as-salam, wa minka as-salam, tabarakta yada jalal al-kam, and so on. Subhanallah 33 times, Alhamdulillah 33 times, Allahu Akbar 33 times, wa la ilaha illallah, and so on. Tayyip, if someone says, okay, I will do this dhikr, but I will do it a different way, with a melodic way, or sound, or make it in group, yalla all together will come, la ilaha illallah, la. From where does this? Why he changed the manner? Or he brings another new dhikr, hay, hay, hu, hu. From where does this? There is no sunnah from Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam to do this. His heart is good. Let's say we believe that he has the sincerity, he has ikhlas doing this. But he made a mistake when it comes to follow Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. He did not follow Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Bring us one hadith that Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, hey, hey, who, we'll do it. No, they cannot find at all. But they just, because they love Islam, they want to do this, then they make this mistake by not following Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. That's if we say that they are good guys. But we don't want to say that they are bad guys in this case. Last class of the worshipping novelties is to sit at time. The best example of that is those people who say that we will pass the 15th of Sha'ban. Every 15th of Sha'ban will fast. Fasting actually as a nafil is required. And Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam used to do a lot of fasting. And he orders his ummah to make fasting in Ramadan and the others, of course. But why to sit a time that Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam did not sit? Did these people have any hadith that Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam told us to fast that special day? Did he give us sitting of a day to worship Allah ta'ala in it, like fasting the 15th of Sha'ban? No. So sitting a time in here is a novelty, is a bid'ah, which is not accepted. Clearly that a Muslim should really follow Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, not because he loves Islam, he will bring extra things. No, he should only love Islam, do it for Allah only, yes, but the way of Rasulullah. The way of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam is a must, because this is part of shahadatayn. Ashhadu anna Muhammadan Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam means that I will do what he told me to do, I will refrain from what he told me not to do, I will worship Allah only his way. That's the case of Ashhadu anna Muhammadan Rasulullah. What is the situation for those people who fall into bid'ah or novelty? What is their decision? How can we decide? What are they? What about this? Bid'ah actually is a wide case. Well, that's really a problem in this case. Bid'ah actually is a wide case. When you come to see the bid'ah, you'll find thousands and thousands of bid'ah among Muslims. You'll see some people announcing the niyyah before salah. You see people who are reciting Al-Fatiha in every case, every occasion, even if they start the programs of the television, or they want to make a wedding, make Al-Fatiha, or they want to make a contract, recite Al-Fatiha. From where is this? Reciting Al-Fatiha is a worshipping. And we, inshallah, we believe that they do this only for Allah. But is this the way of Rasulullah? Where's the evidence? Where's the evidence? Ask these people when they do it, they say this, recite Al-Fatiha for our contract. Fine, give us evidence. Reciting Al-Fatiha is worshipping. Where's the evidence for that? We cannot do any worshipping unless there is evidence. Quran or Sunnah. In this case, we'll be saved from falling into bid'ah or novelty. Every time, any person, whoever he is, if he's the best sheikh in this world, if he says do such and such worshipping, ask him first of all, give me evidence. Worshipping is for Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, yes, for Allah only, subhanahu wa ta'ala, but should be also by the way of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam only. So give me evidence. If this sheikh tells you, go and visit such and such a grave and ask Allah in there. See, he's telling you to ask Allah, not the grave. You'll ask him, give me evidence. Asking Allah is a worshipping, but to do it in such a place, it has to have a belief or evidence. Why do I have to go to Ajmir in order to ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala? Why do I have to go to beside the grave of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam in order to ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala? Give me evidence. Mani evidence. No evidence is there. It's just because they love Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, they want to call Allah beside his grave. From where you get this? Did Abu Bakr do it? Did Umar do it? May Allah anhu arda? Other Sahaba did it? No way. They cannot find even a single hadith to say that he told us to come to his grave and ask him. There is some weak or lied hadith. If you come to my grave and ask Allah to beside my grave, you will get everything you want. That's easy. So many people can make a lot of hadith like this. And poor Muslims, because they don't know Al-Bukhari and Muslim and the other correct hadith, they think this is hadith. Well, take it. They hear that hadith that Muhammad, when Adam alayhi salam was, yani received his soul from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to his body and he woke up, he saw La ilaha illallah Muhammad Rasulullah in the arsh. Subhanallah al-Azim. From where did you get this? In which book they can find this? In Al-Bukhari? No way. In Muslim? No way. Tirmidhi, Nasa'i, Ibn Majah, Ad-Darimi, and so on, they cannot find it. It's just they went to make some... So in this case, step by step, they will fall into worse bid'ah until they go and worship the grace instead of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, saying that this is respecting the awliya. When he tells him, don't go to this place, ask Allah and everywhere, even in your house, and in the masjid, he says, no, we go to these places. If he tells him, no, this is not allowed, they say, oh, you hate the awliya. You hate the people of Allah. You hate the good people, the pious people of Allah. You hate them. And maybe they will give you a fantastic name as a Wahhabi. In this case, because you do not go to the graves and worship them instead of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. The case of worshipping Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is the case that Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam spent most of his da'wah to explain it, and he sallallahu alayhi wa sallam clearly did it. He clearly explained to us that every worshipping should be only the way of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Now verses could be major or explicit disbelief, major kufr. Like what? Like what we have said about the case of saying that Quran has been created. Like worshipping the graves. Because worshipping them here is a worshipping. Going to the graves to worship them is a worshipping. And worshipping has to have dalil, the way of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. But there is no way that Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam told us to the graves and ask Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam beside them or ask them directly. In fact, he clearly told us not to do so. Allahumma la tajal qabri wathanan yu'bad. And he was dying, Aisha, our mother Aisha radiallahu anha told us that while he was dying, he was covering his face with clothes. And when he feels so hot, he takes it off and he says, La'anatullahi ala al-Yahudi wal-Nasara. Ittakhadu qubur anbiya ahl masajid. He was cursing the Jew and Christians because they took and they used the graves of their messengers as places for worshipping. And he clearly told us not to do so with his grave. Did we obey him? Did Muslims really obey him? Or a lot of Muslims now, they went to the grave of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam and tried to worship Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam instead of Allah. Or using the grave area as a worshipping area. Not only Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, they went even to some people they think they are pious people. So many Arabian countries and other Muslim countries and non-Muslim countries, they have a lot of graves. They go there to worship Allah or to worship the grave instead of Allah. So this is a major kufr or a major shirk. Bid'ah or novelty could be, which is number two, a means of polytheism. Yani a way to polytheism. Not polytheism itself, yes, but a way to polytheism. Like constructing buildings on the grave. Those people who construct buildings on the pious graves, pious people graves, they're not going to major kufr or major shirk. But they are walking to it. They are leading people to it. I told you before when we talk about the warning of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam to his ummah, three warnings. I said that if someone is buried in the masjid and the other Muslims are buried in the graveyard, what do you think that the youngest, maybe the oldest, will know that this is only because he has made this masjid, he asked people to bury him in the masjid. Fine. So they know he is only a human being, a regular human being. But for the young generation and the generation after, they will think, why is this person is buried in the masjid? Why the others in the graveyard? He has to have something special. Special means, why did we go and ask him? Why did we not go and ask for barakah, blessing for this? Because he is a pious person. He was buried in the masjid while the others are buried in the graveyard. Exactly the same story happened to the people of Nuh before Nuh alayhi salam. Upon the hadith of Ibn Abbas radiallahu anhuma, he told us that Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said that a human being stayed 10 centuries on Tawheed, monotheism, from Adam. Adam, until 10 centuries after him, they were all in Tawheed, monotheism. Until these five people died. Waddan, Wasuwa'an, Wayaghutha, Wayaghuqa, Wanas. They died almost at the same time, so the people were so shocked, so sad, it was a big tragedy to them, so they decided to build a grave for them, make pictures of them, so they will make them, that's of course the advice of Shaitan. Shaitan advised them to do this. So when they made the grave, they built in the grave, then they started to worship it after a few generations. So Allah Ta'ala sent Nuh to stop them from doing this. So a way to shirk or a means to shirk is the steps of Shaitan, as Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, وَلَا تَتَّبِعُوا خُطُوَاتِ الشَّيْطَانِ. This is number two. Number three, doctrine on disobedience or fisk. Not with the Khawarij or Murji'ah say that, saying that anyone commits a major sin, which is kaba'ir, he's a kafir, or he's a full believer. Al-Khawarij said, if a Muslim fall into zina, or drink alcohol, or take riba, okay, he's a kafir. A'udhu billah. Why we say it's bid'ah or novelty? Because it's not done by Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. He did not tell us this. Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in his holy book, Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, his hadith, did not tell us that a person who falls into major sin, like drinking alcohol and so on, he is a kafir. So from where we get this is novelty or bid'ah. This is fisk. Again, the other side, which is al-murji'ah, they say, a person who says, La ilaha illa Muhammad Rasulullah, he is a complete Muslim, complete believer, even whatever he does whatever he wants. Which is also another mistake, another bid'ah, another novelty that a Muslim should be aware of. Last one is the sin, just a sin. Like what? An example of that is a person who is fasting a regular day. Yani he wants to fast Monday and Thursday, as Muhammad told us. That's sunnah. But he adds a little bit by fasting in the sunlight. But fasting is okay. He's fasting Monday and Thursday as an example, or fasting Ashura, or fasting ninth day of Hijjah, Adul Hijjah, Yawm Arafah. Fine, this is sunnah. But he says, I will fast it in the sunlight, so I'll have more ajr. We tell him, this is bid'ah, novelty. From where you get this? From where you get that you will fast in the sunlight? From where? The story is pretty famous that three of Sahaba came to the house of Muhammad ﷺ, and they asked one of our mothers about the worshipping of Muhammad ﷺ. So she told them that he prays in the night and he sleeps and he fasts sometimes, some days, and he يعني, breakfast sometimes, and he eats meat, and he يعني, a regular life almost. يعني. So these three Sahaba said, well, that's Muhammad and he's already forgiven all of his sins. But for us, no. So one of them said, I will pray the whole night. I will never sleep. The other guy said, I will fast every day. The other Sahabi, or third Sahabi said, I will never marry women. Our mother heard that. So she told Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam when he came back. So he went to them and said, you people said such and such? He said, yes, Ya Rasulullah. He said, no. I am, yeah, the minute before what he said, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, I wake up, I pray and sleep. And I fast and breakfast. And I marry women. And whoever does not like my sunnah, he's not from me. I'm free of him. فَمَنْ رَغِبَ عَنْ سُنَّتِي فَلَيْسَ مِنِّي. So we should worship Allah Ta'ala the way of Rasulullah Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam. We do not want to add extra or change the manner or يعني, set new time or so on. We have to follow Muhammad Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam exactly how he told us. So we will be free of bid'ah inshaAllah. That's what I wanted to say tonight inshaAllah, and I hope Subhanahu Wa Ta'ala he will accept our good deeds and reward us all, you and I, on this lecture we have made, and he makes it subhanahu wa ta'ala as a good deed for us in the judgment day, to be so happy when we see it in our suhuf inshallah. Jazakumullah khair. If you have any questions, please go ahead. Salaamu alaykum. Jazakumullah. Jazakumullah. Now questions mean you have got the whole material, huh? Thank Allah. You got all the information, and you got it, mashallah, absorbed it all. Jazakumullah khair. Salaam alaikum. Salaam alaikum. Hayyak Allah.
I have one little question.
Sure.
Some people argue that ijtihad,
huh?
And what is the compare the law?
Ijtihad actually is another sunnah. Okay, because what are we doing ijtihad upon? What? Upon the dalil, the evidence. So they have some evidences, so they measure. They measure something new for something old. You get my point? It's not that they are making bid'ah in this case, or novelty.
Not creating new things.
Not creating, no. They are just resembling something to something.
Light, yeah,
so, like what? يعني as an example, the ijtihad of Umar ibn al-Khattab رضي الله عنه, I forgot to talk about the case of Bid'a Hassan as they say. Umar ibn al-Khattab رضي الله عنه, يعني in the time of Abu Bakr and the first few years of the Khilafat of Umar رضي الله عنه, there were no tarawih on the masjid with one imam. Then Umar رضي الله عنه, he brought Ubay ibn Ka'b, who was the best reciter of Quran, and he said, you people pray behind him tarawih. And he said, this is ni'mat al-bid'ah to hadhi, yani good bid'ah. So people thought this is a bid'ah is allowed, so we can make bid'ah. Like those people, as an example, another example which is the same way, those people who are making lie hadith, they make lie hadith on Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. When you tell them that Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said clearly, man kadhaba alayya muta'ammidan falyatabawwa maq'aduhu min an-nar. And whoever make a lie on me intentionally, he will have his own place in Jahannam. So when you tell them this, they say, no, we don't lie on Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, we lie for Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. We lie for, yeah, we lie. And Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam needs your lie? Subhanallah al-Azim. Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam doesn't need lie. So in this case, Umar radiallahu anhu only made a sunnah which is already stopped. Because Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he prayed one night in the masjid and some sahaba prayed with him. Then he prayed another night, more sahaba came. Third night, more sahaba came. Fourth night, he did not come. Fifth night, he did not come. Then he said, I knew, the meaning of the hadith, said, I knew you were there, but I did not come to you. Why? He was afraid, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, because he was so merciful with us, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. He was afraid that this tarawih will be a must. So he stopped doing this. Now, Umar, when he brought back this tarawih, did he make bid'ah? Did he make mabawdi? No. He just only made a life one sunnah which is not done. Why Muhammad does not continue? Because he was afraid. Now Muhammad has died already, so no more wahi will come. No, it is not going to be enforced among Muslims or mandatory. So Umar, he made it back again. So this bid'ah is not actually a bid'ah. It is just only a linguistic bid'ah in this case, as we said before. But to a Muslim who comes and changes the way of worshipping, as an example, we said, yani, that's done among a lot of Muslims in the masjid after salah, they make dhikr with a melody voice. Yani, one guy who's doing like this, or they're making in a group way, or those people who make niyyah before salah. Okay, niyyah before salah is really strange. As I said before, that's really, ask this person who makes niyyah before salah. He's reciting niyyah. Yani, making niyyah is okay, in your heart, no problem. But a person says, stand before his salah, say, Allahumma inni nawaitu an usalli arba rakaat al-isha khalfa funa. From where you get this? There's no hadith in this. Even if you ask him, whom are you telling? Whom are you informing? Are you informing Allah? Astaghfirullah, this is kufr. Allah knows everything. You are informing the people around you? This is nifaq. Here. Dissimulation. Or show off. Are you telling yourself? Well, I'm mushkila. The guy is not okay. Because, and if you ask, if you stop a person coming to the masjid, as an example, you came to Salat al-Isha, and you saw a person walking to the masjid, and you know he's going to the masjid, you stop him, stop. Where are you going? Go for Salat al-Isha. So he is there already. And since he heard the Iran, since he made the wudu, the intention is there that he's going to make al-Isha salah, khalas. No need to practice or to sound this niyyah. It's already there. So this is counted as another bid'ah, and so on. So many bid'ah you find. Yani, subhanallah, you go to Western Islamic countries from Morocco up to Egypt, or you go to the Eastern Islamic countries from Saudi Arabia up to Afghanistan and Pakistan and so on, you will find Muslims making bid'ahs. But these bid'ahs are levels. Some of them will exclude from Islam, some of them only a sin, as we said, like the person who is fasting in the sunlight. So they are levels. We have to be careful not to put them in the same level. But bid'ah is bid'ah. Novelty is novelty. And it's very, very dangerous for Muslims. Ijtihad is not it. Ijtihad is done by Sahaba. Ijtihad is done by Abu Bakr, Umar, Uthman, Ali. So this is Sunnah. عليكم بسنتي وسنة الخلفاء الراشدين المهديين من بعدي. So their Sunnah is Sunnah of Muhammad صلى الله عليه وسلم. So if Abu Bakr رضي الله عنه make Ijtihad, or Umar, or Uthman, or Ali, all of them, they are doing Sunnah. Even the ulama later on will make Ijtihad, they are only comparing something to something. If you have something new, like car now. Cars were not in the time of Muhammad صلى الله عليه وسلم or Sahaba. What are you going to do with these cars? When we ride the car, we do the dhikr that Muhammad used to do when we ride the camel. Bismillah, alhamdulillah, subhanah, alladhi sakhara lana hadha, wa ma kunna lahu muqrin. How did we do this? We compare. Camel was red, this is also to be red. Same thing. This is used to travel, this is used to travel. to move around. So this is so it's a case of ijtihad or comparing and so on, qiyas and so on. Jazakumullah khair. Jazakumullah khair. Salam.
Yes, so in India, in my place particularly, Muslims were gathering and they are calling the verses in a form of a group and they are reciting the some verses of Quran like La ilaha illa Allah, subhanaka, and things like that.
Yeah.
And they are reciting for more than 1,25,000
in a group manner.
Mm-hmm.
Was it allowed? Was it, is it there in authentic hadith?
Ask, is there if there is a hadith, do it. Always, if you want to do worshipping, have two cases. Only for Allah, only the way of Rasulullah. Only for Allah, inshallah, this is niyyah is good, inshallah, inshallah. We believe that they have a good niyyah in this case. But is this the way of Rasulullah? Did Muhammad Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam bring Sahaba, make them groups and make this of the way of dhikr? No, then we will not do it. How are we going to do way of dhikr? Alhamdulillah. While you are lying in your bed, while you are walking, while you are driving your car, while you are sitting in your house, while you are walking the street, while you are in work, while whatever you make dhikr. As he told صلى الله عليه وسلم, he told Jabir ibn Abdullah and Mu'adh ibn Jabal, لا يزال لسانك رطبا لذكر الله. يعني make your tongue always wet of dhikr of Allah سبحانه وتعالى. Always. لا إله إلا الله. صلى الله عليه وسلم. يعني I have seen شيخنا الشيخ بن باز رحمة الله عليه. He was يعني in TV programs or on the masjid in درس. While people are asking him, he was making istighfar. And he listening. سبحان الله. يعني استغفار خلاص. It's a habit of him. His debate, خلاص. His tongue is used to istighfar. استغفر الله. استغفر الله. استغفر الله. Loud, not loud. He, يعني, he hears the question. When he's making istighfar, he hears the question. So if we do this in our life, subhanallah, we will be enjoying our life. Because every time you make istighfar, every time you make dhikr, this dhikr will make your scale on the judgment day heavy. فَمَنْ ثَقُلَتْ مَوَازِينُهُ فَهُوَ فِي عِيشَ الرَّاضِيَةِ فِي جَنَّةِ. Subhanallah. So this dhikr will make, يعني, make dhikr. How much dhikr we have يعني, dhikr Muhammad Hassan told us? He told us so many dhikr. Everything in our life is dhikr. Getting into the masjid, dhikr. Out of the masjid, dhikr. Going to the home, dhikr. In the market, dhikr. In your bed, dhikr. Before you sleep, dhikr. Before you come to your wife, there's dhikr. When you wake up, there's dhikr. Subhanallah. So dhikr is there, dhikr. Your heart will be clean. الَّذِينَ آمَنُوا وَتَطْمَئِنُّ قُلُوبُهُمْ بِذِكْرِ اللَّهِ. Dhikr is الْإِيمَان. Dhikr, you feel calmness in your heart by making a lot of dhikr. Always, alhamdulillah, alhamdulillah. Astaghfirullah. Then in this case, wallahi, if you have the worst tragedy in life, you will be happy. Because your heart is close to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, it's hand to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. You don't worry. But those people who are not remembering Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, they will feel a very bad life. In fact, they will say that the thing you are remembering in your life a lot, you will remember it when you die. While dying, those people who love money, they will talk about money. That happened so much, and even here in Riyadh, I have seen, and some other brothers have seen, people who are dying saying, okay, that apartment, that take the rent, take it. That, land, don't sell it. Unless you sell it, yeah, you are dying, say, la ilaha illallah, that's it. Astaghfirullah. Why the good Muslims who are making the dhikr, they are dying and they are remembering Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala.
So, but fixing the you know, the numbers in
125,000. No, not numbering, not the way, not anything. Unless it's done by, Imam Hassan told us to make subhanallah 33 times, right? After Salah. Yeah. Alhamdulillah 33 times. Allahu Akbar 33 times. He told us, he did it by his right hand only. By his fingers. Not by sabha or anything. So we'll do it the same way. Why we change the way that Muhammad Hassan did it? Is it better to have sabha or to use by his fingers as Muhammad Hassan? Khalas. That's the key. So we are always doing the way, and go and read the hadith about this dhikr. This dhikr you said. Of course there is a hadith. But is this authentic hadith? This is one case. Second case. This authentic hadith, how did he tell us to do it? Did he tell us do it as the way you like it? Or he did it a way or told us to do the way? Then we will do it the same way. We will not change the way. Then in this case, we are following Muhammad Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam. Even because we love Islam, we love Muhammad Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam, we do a lot of dhikr. But we have to do this dhikr or ibadah the way of him Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam. So is this done by Muhammad Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam? Make sure. Check these people. I haven't seen these people are doing this. I haven't seen these people making melodic way or sound of dhikr or making this in group.
It's very common in
I know. Or everywhere. But yeah. Just ask him, is this by Muhammad Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam? You love Muhammad Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam? We do. If you do love Muhammad Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam, why didn't you follow him? Why you say you love him and then you change the way of his way? Loving Muhammad Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam means we'll do the same way. So why don't this way of dhikr by numbers or by thousands? Ibn Mas'ud radiallahu anhu, by the way, he passed by a masjid on Iraq. Mas'ud was one of the scholars of Sahaba, and he saw people having small pieces of rocks or stones. Okay. And they say, make 100 tasbih.
Yes.
Subhanallah, 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 right. Subhanallah. Finish. Make 100. Allahu Akbar, Allahu Akbar, Allahu Akbar. So instead, they said, what are you doing? He said, we are making dhikr. We are counting, so we make sure we don't make mistakes. He said, don't worry. Allah will count for you. You don't need to do this. You are one of two ways. You are better than Muhammad Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam, or you are in bid'ah. So
let's
have. Did Muhammad Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam count by number? By stone? Did he? Stone was available at that time. Why did Muhammad Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam use stone? Did that? So he did it by his own fingers. So right hand, even with left hand, there's no way to say that he used his left hand. Subhanallah, 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 Subhanallah. So the best way is to follow Muhammad Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam.
But when reaching there in India also, I have seen that I have observed in Ramadan, during the Shab-e-Qadr, night of the Qadr. In which they are gathering the people in the form of prayer, Salah.
Mm-hmm.
And they are calling the Salah as the Salat al-Tasbih.
Salat al-Tasbih. Heard of it, yes.
Bajama. And they are calling the
Bajama?
Bajama, yes. Is it around?
The hadith is there very weak. Hadith of Salat al-Tasbih is very weak. No way to prove that it's by Muhammad Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam. So if it's a weak hadith, we cannot really use it.
So it comes in the care of the
could, yes, could, yes, comes going in the bid'ah case.
Now they fix the 27th.
Fixing 27th also another case. From where they got this? From where we got this? Let's look at the 27th. Yes, it was once in the time of Muhammad Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam, 27th. But as we understand from these so many hadith about the Qadr, it could be one Ramadan in 21st, another Ramadan in 23rd, another Ramadan in could be. It's moving. And Laylatul Qadr is moving on the odd numbers of the last 10 days. The nights, oh, sorry. Huh? So in this case, why we certainly say 27 is the Laylatul Qadr? From where we get this? Fi hadith? No evidence. So always as we said, some people say, this is very hard, how can we change? If when it's built wrongly, it's easy to rebuild them correctly. With jihad, with people, jihad doesn't have to be jihad with weapons. Jihad is to meet people and talk to them once, twice, three times until they understand Islam, alhamdulillah. And as you see, a lot of brothers, alhamdulillah, I met from all around the world, they always tell us, alhamdulillah, now people are really changing. Really changing, alhamdulillah. People are, start to leave these superstitious stories about this Khalandar Baba, this Khalandar. Khalas, people start to understand that this is khalas. Muslims, alhamdulillah, become an alleged person. People, they know more and more about Islam, alhamdulillah. Everyone in this world, nothing here only. Okay, so they are start to live in this. They think, okay, if you call Ajmer while you are in the sea, Ajmer will come and pick you up and take you to another.
Yes, Murshid.
Murshid, yeah. Murshid. That is the name of the Subhanallah. Maybe this is the, so from where is this? This is only a superstition. That, did Muhammad Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam do this? Did Muhammad Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam told us to call him when we are in the sea, he will carry us? Never said this. So is this Ajmer better than Muhammad Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam? So we will ask the only one, Subhanahu Wa Ta'ala, he will take care of us. Because Muhammad Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam, the beloved person for us, told us to ask Allah only. And he, Subhanahu Wa Ta'ala, told us also in his book to ask him only. وَأَنَّ الْمَسَاجِدَ لِلَّهِ فَلَا تَدْعُوا مَعَ اللَّهِ أَحَدًا. Nobody. Except Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. But doesn't mean that we hate these buried people. We don't hate them. Because some of them, or most of them inshallah, are good people, good Muslims. So we love them, but we don't give them what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala only deserves. Jazakum Allah khair. Salaam.
What is the place of secularists in Islam?
They are mostly hypocrites. Because they show something that they had something. If they are clearly saying, they are cops. Why? Because secularists actually they say that deen of Islam is not good enough. It's not good enough for our life. So they need to import legislations or rules for the
economics, like
economics rules for politics. They say Islam is no good for these things. Subhanallah. Muhammad Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam did not know what you know. How these people know?
Subhanallah.
Islam is Al-Yawma Akmaltu Lakum Deenakum. Everything is in Islam. So why do you need to go to import? But because of these people, especially those people who have lived in the West, unfortunately, those people who have lived in the West, they have seen this fantastic civilization, materialistic life. They think that Islam has brought us back. Because we are Muslims, we are back. No, ya Habibi. We were Muslims, and strong Muslims, and we were advanced. And if you go back 700 years ago, you find that those people were coming to our universities in Baghdad and Dimashq and Andalus and Cairo, they came to learn. Did I tell you the story of these Germans? The educated Germans. That's what was 400, 500 years ago. They were sitting in their places, they're talking on their German language, local language. And they, when they want to show the others that they are educated people, they come to Arabic. Now it's upside down. When we want to say, show people that we are educated people, huh? We bring some, you know, yeah.